Hi everyone, and welcome to this informational video on the placebo effect, brought to you by the Demystifying Medicine Program. So, what is a placebo? A placebo can be described as anything that resembles a real medical treatment, but in reality isn't. One key element of placebos is that they do not include any active compound meant to affect health. An active compound can be described as a chemical substance capable of interacting with proteins in our body. Often, researchers use placebos during studies to help them understand what effect a new drug or some other treatment might have on a particular condition. However, sometimes a person can have a positive or a negative reaction to taking a placebo. But how does that happen? Let's first start with its history. In the 1700s, doctors began using the term placebo when they realized that fake treatments could help improve people's symptoms. So, when a treatment wasn't available, patients would be given a placebo, which helped relieve their symptoms. In fact, the word placebo originated from a Latin phrase meaning "I shall please," hinting at a history of soothing patients. Interest in the placebo effect has increased significantly over the following few decades. By 1920, Graves et al. Published and introduced the first ever article in a well-established journal titled The Lancet, mentioning the placebo effect. Since then, areas such as the prefrontal cortex, the area responsible for higher level thinking, was found to integrate the treatment cortex clues surrounding placebo, which allows for environmental factors to play a role in the placebo phenomenon. Other brain regions involved in the making of neural chemicals like dopamine, oxytocin, and opioids is also triggered. Such integration of varying neuronal signals has a strong calming and anti-pain effect in response to placebo. As the neurochemicals increase, an efflux of opioids are generated by a specific region of the brain highlighted in yellow. Ultimately, the patient then is able to manage their pain. We've now mentioned the idea of increased opioid production in the brain. But let's take a look at how the opioid mechanism works on a neuronal level. Let's first imagine that we have a patient requiring some form of medicine to treat their pain and to feel stronger. They first take in the placebo treatment, thinking that it's a real treatment that will make them feel better. On a physiological level, certain functions like blood pressure begin to decrease, which can be measured by a sphygmomanometer, and brain activity begins to change. The patient then begins to improve symptomatically and begins feeling much better than they did before. So we can now go over how this phenomenon works on a molecular level. In our first scenario here, we have an opioid mechanism involving a morphine injection. Once the morphine is injected, it is able to bind to the opioid receptor found on a neuron, which then elicits the termination of the pain signal. Contrastingly, the placebo mechanism works in a similar way. When a placebo is given, a reward pathway is activated, which then releases endorphin. Endorphin is then able to bind to the opioid receptor and terminate the pain signal as well. To prove this hypothesis, we can look at attempting to inhibit the placebo pathway. When naloxone, which is an opioid antagonist, is given, it is instead able to bind to the opioid receptor, which then prevents the endorphin from binding, therefore allowing the pain signal to persist. Such experiment then proves that the placebo effect might be following an opioid mechanism. But how is the neuro-response monitored? Let's take a look at some brain images that have been taken to monitor brain activity when given a placebo. We first see that the anterior insular cortex is highly active. This part of the brain is responsible for emotional feelings. Next, we have the insular cortex, which is involved in sensory processing. The RACC can then integrate emotion and cognition learning, while the ventral striatum helps drive immediate reward gratification. It is hypothesized that these brain functions are key players involved in the placebo effect. However, much research yet remains unknown for how they are able to integrate with one another. With that in mind, we can now introduce the novel discovery of the placebome. The placebome is a hypothesized group of genome molecules that include genes, microRNAs, proteins, and much more. So let's take a deeper dive into the placebome. In 2017, Wang et al. Published a paper on a network analysis of genomic bases of the placebo effect. Herein, they were able to pinpoint an interconnected map of varying genes involving 54 placebo modules linked to specific genes capable of playing a role in this phenomenon. Such genes include BDNF, which is involved in stress and reward response, AKT1, involved in motor impairments, and CHRNA5, involved in smoking abstinence. Ultimately, this is groundbreaking developments of the genetic contributions involving the placebo effect. This now concludes our short video on the placebo effect. It's really not all in your head.